good to see everybody here tonight. We welcome those that might be visiting with us. We're glad you're here, and we trust you'll come back and be with us again. We welcome everyone in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to our gospel service tonight. We trust that tonight, if you're here unsaved, that tonight will be your night when you will turn and accept the Lord Jesus as your very own. Thank you so much, choir, for that opening number, and Brother Adam. Now we're going to rise and sing number 882. Number 882, I must needs go home by the way of the cross. There's no other way but this. I shall ne'er get sight of the gates of light if the way of the cross I miss. Number 882. Tonight that the way of the cross leads on. Shall we look to the Lord in prayer? Our Father in heaven, we're so thankful that the way of the cross leads on. We're so thankful tonight, Father, that you've seen fit to lengthen out another day of grace whereby men and women can be saved. And Father, as this service is convened tonight, we pray as these songs are sung, as your servant, Brother Steve Price, comes to proclaim a message for thee. We pray that the Holy Spirit would move about in our midst tonight, those that may be watching by way of television. Father, we pray that as words are sung and said tonight, that the Holy Spirit would convict men and women of their lost condition and cause them to realize that today is the day of salvation, tomorrow may be too late. Father, may they realize that time is running out and they need to be saved. May they realize that they're lost. They need a Savior. So we pray for this meeting tonight. Bless each face of it. Father, we pray for those that couldn't be here, those that are not well. We commend them to thee tonight. Those that are recovering from surgeries, we continue to pray for them that you'll lead and restore them back to full health and strength again. And Father, we just pray for those of your people, the household of faith, Father, that you would help us as your children, that as we move about on this island, wherever we go, that we would bear a testimony for thee and let others know that we have something that's worth living for. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who died to save us and lives to keep us. Blessed be his holy name. Bless us now and make us a blessing for thee as we further wait in your presence, giving thee thanks in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Right now, we're going to be favored with a solo, I Pledge Allegiance to the Lamb.
I pledge allegiance to the Lamb. With all my strength, with all I am, I will sing to honor his commands. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb.
I have heard how Christians long ago were brought before a tyrant's throne. They were told that he would spare their lives if they would renounce the name of Christ. But one by one they chose to die. The Son of God, they would not deny, like a great angelic choir sings. I can almost hear their voices ring. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb with all my strength. With all I am, I will seek to honor his commands. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb. Now the years have come, and the years have gone. And the cause of Jesus still goes on. Now our time has come to count the cost, to reject this world, to embrace the cross. And one by one let us live our lives for the one who died. Give us life till the trumpet sounds on the final day. Let us proudly stand and boldly say, I pledge allegiance to the Lamb with all my strength, with all I am. I will seek to honor his commands. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb, to the Lamb of God, who bore my pain, who took my place, who bore my shame. I will seek to honor his commands. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb with all my strength, with all I am. I will seek to honor his commands. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb with all my strength, with all I am. I will seek to honor his God.
books again to number 200. We're going to rise and sing. We have heard a joyful sound. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. You believe that tonight? Jesus saves? Amen. Hallelujah. He's still in the saving business. Whosoever will may come. Spread the gladness all around. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward 'tis, our Lord's command. Jesus saves. Number 200. Thank you so much for your good singing. Now the choir is coming with their last selection, Love Grew Where the Blood Fell.
See my Jesus on the cross, the people crying. Looking on, a man would think it tragedy. But what this world could not see was when they nailed him to that tree, it would break the chains of sin. Captivity.
Yeah.
Number 123. Come to the Savior, make no delay. Here in his word, he has shown us the way. Here in our midst, he's standing today, tenderly saying, come. He's saying, come. Will you come to him tonight? Joyful will that meeting be. We'll rejoice. The angels will rejoice in heaven tonight. If you're unsaved, don't put it off. Come to him tonight. Number 123. Good singing. Now it's my pleasure to call on my friend, Brother Steve Price.
Let's have a word of prayer, then I'd like to introduce a little topic this evening through the world of medicine, and so I'm glad Gerald mentioned about his situation, and then we'll go to the text before us. Our Father, this evening we come in the name of the Lord Jesus, and we'd love to ask you to do something that is absolutely astounding to us tonight, and that's to watch the Spirit of God take his word and bring forth the fruit of souls saved. In Jesus' name, amen. Now I'm going to take you to a portion of God's words tonight, which will serve as a spiritual stethoscope. And when we look at God's word, what I'm asking you to do, before we get into the text tonight, what I'm asking you to do is to agree that you will allow the stethoscope to be placed on your spiritual heart. Will you do that with me? Now, you don't have to agree with what it says, but I want you to let the Word of God have a chance to examine your soul. So whether you're listening on the TV channel or you're here in this room, agree with me. You don't have to raise your hand. Just silently say, okay, I'll let God's Word touch my chest tonight and listen to my spiritual condition. All right, now turn to the book of James. We've been doing a little study in James in the few weeks that we've had together. And then so studying the book of James, we've crept up on chapter 3. And chapter 3 is a tough chapter, not because it's hard reading. It's a tough chapter because of what it says. It's like the spiritual stethoscope, and it's going to uncover some things. Like that man on my cot, I uncovered his heart condition. Here we're going to uncover some things. Now let's read it together, and I'm going to read it in two paragraphs. So follow along, and I'm first going to begin in verse 1. My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. For we all stumble in many things. For we all stumble in many things. Anybody stumble in anything? Anybody stub their big moral toe on anything? Well, here's what he says. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man. Perfect means complete. And also able to he is a perfect man, able also to bridle the whole body. Indeed, we put bits in horses' mouths that they may obey us. and we turn their whole body. Look also at ships, although they are not so large and are driven by fierce winds, they are turned by a very small rudder wherever the pilot desires. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. See how great a little fire kindles? The tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature and is set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast, and bird or reptile or creature of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by mankind, but no man can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceeds blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be so. Does a spring send forth fresh water and bitter from the same opening? Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olives, or a grapevine bear figs? Thus no spring yields both salt water and fresh. Now, I read a paragraph to you, and we're going to work through it because I'm going to use it as a stethoscope for our soul tonight. So what does it say? Well, the stethoscope is focusing on the organ of the tongue, of what we say, spiritually speaking. And he says, right off the bat, he says, you know, listen, you need to understand something. That if you're really going to be a person who is a well-packaged individual, it's going to show up in certain ways. And you know how it shows up? It shows up in what you say. It shows up in how you say it. It shows up in, and he uses the organ, the tongue, right? Now, in this little description, he says, let me see if I can illustrate something to you. And he uses a horse and a ship to describe that this small little portion of the body can actually rule the entire course of one's life. How many of us know that? Where we have said things that have actually had such deep consequences that they've changed the course of your life forever. Maybe you've done that in your own life, where you've said things in a marital relationship or a job relationship, and it's caused destruction, and it's been an unalterable thing to change. And yet, such a small piece of your spiritual anatomy has a way of causing such great direction. This is what he says about the horse. It's got a bridle, you know, those little things in the mouth, the metal thing, and yet with it you can control a 1,000-pound animal. When I was young, I was in Illinois, and I was about 5 or 6 years old, and my cousins were there, and they had horses. And so I got on the horse, and they began to lead me around. And the next thing I know, my cousin gets distracted, and the horse keeps going and going. And I'm doing everything. Whoa, huh, stop, listen, and I don't know the magic words, and I'm trying. And the horse goes all the way around the barn, all the way around the front yard of their house, all the way back to where my family was standing, and I was petrified, and I'm a little 5-6-year-old boy, and I go, how do you stop this thing? And my uncle says, you just pull back on this rein here, and it catches their bridle, and the horse stops. I said, oh, I thought I was a goner. And that's what he's illustrating. He says, listen, such a small device can control such an animal. And if a little pint-sized 5 or 6-year-old has control of that bridle, so he controls that animal who is 10 times his size. Now, same thing is made to the ship. Look at what it says. It says, look also at ships. Now, I have to tell you, I've talked to about every conversation where I could get into it, I've really asked about everyone's shipping business, you know, their fishing business and their boat. And I'm kind of fascinated by it because, I don't know if you know this, but we don't have ocean in Kansas, okay? It doesn't exist. We have bodies of water, we call them streams. But you have a backyard that looks like a swimming pool, all right? And so when I'm talking to you, we talk a little bit about their size of their motors and the length of their and the breadth of their ships, and I'm just kind of fascinated by it all. But you know, the rudder is kind of important. We've never talked about the rudder. It turns out that a rudder, if you do some calculations, the density, the weight, and the surface of the rudder is less than 1% of the entire vessel. and yet it controls 99% of the vessel. But I tell you, that's what happens to us. Our mouths will get us into trouble. Our mouths can control things in such a way that we can't really predict it, right? I'll never forget things that I've said to other people, hurtful things I can't take back. They've caused that kind of destruction, that little urge to speak what's in my head. Boy, I tell you, that's a dangerous thing. Well, the tongue is like this. In fact, he even goes on to say, he says, you know, the tongue is not only controlling everything, it controls in a negative way. And look at it as a fire starter. Look at what it says here. See how great a forest a little fire is kindled. Now, a brother was telling me today about the fire on his boat today. It was just a small spark, but before you know it, the entire upper portion of the room they're working with was in flames. In fact, I heard several stories of fires on boats, engine fires and cabin fires, and it just made me not want to go with you, actually. But the point is that this is how it happens. It's such a little thing that flames up. And this is what he says. The tongue, the words that come out of your mouth, they're like a fire. Verse 6, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body, sets on fire the course of nature. It is set on fire by hell. What does he mean by that? He's saying, listen, the things that come out of your mouth are actually coming from a heart of sin, a heart that is very much similar to the dynamics that would be the dwelling or the in judgment for sin and Satan. He's saying it's made up of that evil, that toil, that rebelliousness, that stubbornness, that self-centeredness, that pride. All those things are in the person that come out of the mouth. You see, that's the problem. And you see, what we don't realize is that we're walking spiritual time bombs, and we may not actually see it until we put the stethoscope of God's word on our souls and we say, you know what? I do that very thing. My mouth is out of control. When I'm angry, I say things like that are so hurtful and painful. I hate you. Get out of my life. I don't want to see you again. When I'm intoxicated, when I'm under the influence, I do things, I say things which I would never do. And we recognize that there is a huge force within you. The Bible calls it, the Bible says, well, you're really something that's quite associated with Satan, set on fire by hell. Now, the Lord Jesus told us what this was. Turn, if you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew chapter 15. You don't need to turn there if you're unfamiliar with the Scriptures. I'll read it for you. But Matthew chapter 15 tells us of our heart condition. And the Lord Jesus is teaching, and the disciples, they had a little question. And they said in verse 12, the disciples said, verse 13, verse 15, that's where I went. Then Peter answered and said to him, explain to us the parable. And the parable was that, you know, it's not what defiles you that you take in, but what comes out of your mouth. And here's what the Lord Jesus said. Are you still without understanding? Do you not yet understand that whatever enters the mouth and goes into the stomach and is eliminated, but those things which proceed out of the mouth, those words that come out of your mouth, they come from your heart. That defiles a man, that the heart is corrupted. For out of the heart proceeds evil thoughts and murders and adulteries and fornications and thefts and false witnesses and blasphemies. These are the things that defile a man. But to eat with unwashed hands, that doesn't defile a man. He's saying this, listen, it's not so much what you take in that actually makes things bad. What makes things bad is you got a heart of sin. And let me tell you, that guy that night that sat in my ER, he had a blockage in his heart. He did not even know it until we uncovered it, and he was near death. And sometimes tonight, people come, they hear the gospel, and they don't even realize that you're a walking time bomb. How do you know that? Just stop, put the stethoscope of God's word on your mouth, and hear what comes out. And you recognize those words are destructive, they're painful, they're daggers. Just ask yourself, when is the last time that happened? I know the last time it happened for me. It was easy. I was just rude to my wife, the one who loves and cares for me. I was rude to my children and various things. Those things come out so quickly. And listen, as a person who comes to this meeting tonight, that might be you. And you can't stand it. You wish you can change it. Oh, let's read on for a moment. Look at this. It's untamable. Go back to James chapter 3, verse 7. For every kind of beast and bird or reptile or creature of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by mankind, but no one can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil, just like the Lord Jesus described it, full of deadly poison. You know, I don't know if you've ever been to Florida. Maybe you have, but they have there this place called SeaWorld, right? And they're famous for having Shamu the whale, the killer whale, right? It's kind of a beautiful animal with big white splotches and black splotches. And this, you know, it's called the killer whale. And they got him in this big tank. And the little trainer will hold up a fish right there. And that whale will come right out and just grab the little fish out of the hand and then go back into water. I'm afraid he'd take the whole person with him, right? So it's possible to train animals in that way from the sea. It's possible to train reptiles. Maybe you've seen them where the boa constrictor snake, the one that chokes you to death, will come out in the and around the trainer and wrap itself around the man's neck and not squeeze the life out of him. It's possible to train lions where they'll roar, their mouths will be wide open, and the trainer will put his head in the center of the mouth, and the lion won't have dinner that night, will be controlled. It's possible. But did you know that it is impossible to train that which comes from your heart? You are not going to be salvageable. There has to be a fundamental change that occurs in the soul. This is what James is saying. It can't. It's such a desperately wicked thing that when it comes out, the evil in the heart, it's destructive, it's untamable, and listen, it's deadly. Look at what it says in the next phrase, full of deadly poison. Now that word poison in the original language means venom, right? Now, you have many creatures in the sea that have venom, but I'm mostly familiar with snake venom. See, emergency medicine guys, we're supposed to be experts in snake bites, you know. And one of the things about snake bites is this, is they hurt and they kill in two different ways. If you get a snake bite on your hand, you immediately it puffs up and swells, and you have to be aggressive, and you have to get the anti-venom, usually from the zoo, and you have to infiltrate it around the wound, and you have to be aggressive, because within hours the hand will get three times its size, and so sometimes so big that you'll actually cut off the blood supply to fingers. But that's just the first hurt. The second hurt is that venom gets into the bloodstream and slowly makes its way back all the way to the central organs of the chest. And once it gets into the heart, it gets pumped to the rest of the body, like to the brain or to the muscles. And in that venom, it has certain kinds of toxins which paralyze the muscles, which stops the rhythmic motion, the rhythmicity that comes from the brain telling the heart to beat all the time. And that's the killer. You die because those toxins actually stop the breathing and the heartbeat of a person. You see, this is what the tongue does. It has sometimes an immediate effect. It destroys, and then it has that long-term effect, doesn't it? It has that long-term way of causing pain and suffering in the hearer. You and I both have had words in our hearts that we've heard from years ago, decades ago, when we were children. Maybe a sibling said something so harsh to you. Maybe a friend said something so harsh to you. And you remember that like it's yesterday. How can we deal with this? This is a bad heart condition, isn't it? And yet this is what we have. This is what he's saying. Just let the stethoscope of God's word listen to that for a moment. Do you hear yourself? Can you acknowledge, can you see that there's something desperately wrong? Yes, there is, isn't there? You know, as a physician, that's the hardest thing to tell somebody. One Christmas I was working. It was Christmas Day. And in a matter of 12 hours, I had to tell three people they had cancer on Christmas Day. Wow, that's hard to hear, isn't it? Of course it is. To look at yourself and God's word and say, you know what? That is me. I've got a mouth, a heart that spews forth anger, spews forth selfishness, spews forth pride, spews forth jealousy, gossip. And I try to stop it, and I can't. It's out of control. I've caused many fires here and there. Some fires are long-lasting that have burned on for decades in my family. Some fires have destroyed people's lives, and I don't know what to do about it. Listen, If that's where you are tonight, I want you to know that's the person God loves to deal with, who recognizes there's a problem, who sees the fact that in this particular area, only one facet of your spiritual being, you can see there is desperate wickedness going on. And that's exactly what James is saying. Now, what is it that what is it that's going to change us? Well, let's just look at the next paragraph. It says, and I'd like you to begin reading with me in verse 14. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your heart, now that's the thing that causes the bad, the poor speech. Do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom, that is, of an evil heart, does not proceed from above, but is earthly, sensual, look, demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. What he's saying is this: listen, you've got this heart condition, and it's got an evil touch to it. It's the nature of sin. And if you think you can reform it, if you think you can help it along through self-help groups or some type of therapy, it's unreformable. You need it to die. Listen, you got to cut out the cancer. Now, how does that happen? How can I get rid of this drive to be so self-centered and so angered and prideful and lustful? How does it get out of me? Well, that's what Jesus Christ has done. You see, the book of Romans, don't turn to it, I'll read it to you. The book of Romans says, listen, there is no one righteous, no, not one, not a single person. In fact, everybody, no one seeks after God. Everybody's turned to their own way. In fact, there's poison of snakes under their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Listen, I know about your condition. I know you're a walking time bomb. I know this is the case. But I want you to know, I've let that be shown. I've let that be revealed. I've diagnosed your problem so that you can have a solution. That's what he says. Look, it says here, whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law that every mouth may be stopped so that no one can make an excuse anymore. But God, he was wrong. That's why I chewed him out. But God, they hurt me. That's why I chewed them out. That's why I said what I said. God says, no, listen, there's no excuse. Every mouth will be stopped and all the world will become guilty before God. That's what this tongue does. It convicts us. It's an indictment against us. The evidence of our evil heart is right there. God says, this is how it is. Now, why do I do that? Because I need everyone to be guilty so that I might be able to offer God's solution to everyone. And this is what he says. The righteousness of God, apart from the law, is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, given the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe, for there is no difference, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood. You know what he means by that? That's in Romans chapter 3, verse 21. He's saying this, listen, what God has done for our heart condition, which needs to be dealt with, is he's given you his son. He's given you of himself. And what he did is he actually took your penalty, your judgment, your aftermath for this heart condition, he took that upon himself. He received the full blow of what it takes to deal with this heart condition. And what does it take to deal with this heart condition of evil? It takes death. You can't reform it. It has to die. And that's why the Lord Jesus died on the cross. He was, as it says here, the satisfaction for this wrong. He satisfied the holy justice system of God. The chief justice of the universe sat and he condemned us and he said, this is your evil heart. It's produced a penalty of death. You earned that death. But I tell you what I will do. I can't take away the death because that would subvert the justice of God. Who wants a compromised court? But what I will do is I will give you my life so that you would live. I will take your death. And that's what it says. Jesus is the one who is the satisfaction for that death. He gave his own life on the cross, died and rose again. Now, that's the beauty of what's happened. But let me tell you what he does. He does something more than that. When you trust Christ as Savior, he gives you a new heart. Don't you want a new heart? Don't you want to not be selfish, not be prideful, not always having to be right, not always having to have the last word? Wouldn't you like that to be your spirit? Wouldn't you like that changed? And this is what God says he does. He says, listen, that nature that drives you to sin like that, that nature that produces the evil things out of your mouth, you know what? When I died on that cross, that nature died with me. I became sin. And nature died with me. So when you trust in me, guess what? That part of you also dies, my friend. That also dies. And that old man was crucified with Christ. And what happens in is he says this, and as Jesus was raised out of the dead so and has new life, so he gives you new life. He gives you his nature, his spiritual DNA. It's a heart transplant, better than anyone ever done in the world. And what he does is he gives you his passions, his thinking, his motivations, his speech, his outlook. He gives you his selflessness. He gives you his mercy. He gives you his grace. And all of a sudden, out of that same mouth that produced all the evil and all the bitterness, now out of that same mouth comes mercy, fruits of peace, of righteousness, love. All those things. Why? Because not only was your penalty taken care of, he's given you the freedom from the power of sin. You see, so many people have failed to realize that God has given you a total package. It's not just being saved from a bad outcome, but it's actually giving you the ability to live a new and different life. When you love it, that when somebody really cheats you, instead of using your mouth to tear them down, you actually could use your mouth to speak words of grace. Think about it. Think about it. That's what the gospel does for you. That's what Jesus Christ does for you. The Bible, back in James, it says, this wisdom that he gives you through the work of Jesus Christ is a wisdom that's from above. It sounds like things that are pure and peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy, good fruits, without partiality, without hypocrisy. The fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. This is a transforming work. Now, I don't know how you are, but there are some in the hearing tonight who are sick and tired of living in a way that is so destructive. They're diagnosing it tonight because they identify with the Word of God that the mouth has been speaking only that which is evil all the time, and they want it to stop. I want you to know it can stop. Do you know how it stops? It first of all stops by a clear recognition that your heart is judged by God, judged to be convicted and sentenced to death. God would say, I can't spare you from the death, but I tell you what I can do, I can take your death. And when he so took your death, he took your penalty for that, those crimes of your heart, that heart condition. And when he did that, he then also gave you himself, breathed his life into you, put his spiritual being in you, his spiritual thinking and nature. And now he gives you the opportunity to live a totally transformed life, a totally different life. And if you're here and that's where you are, then I would want to tell you, based on the authority of God's word, this is your night. This is the night where the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords has truly offered you a transforming work done, wrought at his own hands when he died on the cross and rose again. Oh, I beg you, don't miss this. Let me end this evening by telling you of another patient. This patient had, and I think I've told you this before, but it really resonates with me. This patient had been doing cocaine all night long. It was 7 a.m. He was my first patient of my morning shift, and he came into my ER, and he was complaining of chest pain. Cocaine has a way of constricting your blood vessels and can do that to the heart and actually cause a heart attack, in young people even. And he was worried he was having a heart attack, and I checked him out, and he wasn't having a heart attack. But he was very, very, very depressed, very despondent. He hung his head, just shook it back and forth, and I was about ready to walk out the room, and I said, "I bet you feel like cocaine has a chain around your neck, don't you?" He didn't look up at me. He goes, "Yeah." I said, "I bet you try to walk away from it sometimes, and you get so far away, and suddenly the chain is taut, and it yanks you back." He says, "Yeah." He looked up at me then. He goes, "Yeah, that's exactly my life. I tried to stop cocaine dozens of times, and I can't. Every time I get enough away, I just get yanked back into it, and I hate it, and I hate it." I said to him, "I want you to know that I know a God who breaks the chains of sin." That's what I've described to you tonight. Maybe the chains of sin are showing up in your life by what comes out of your mouth. Maybe it's showing up by what habits you might have, what kind of things you find joy in. You call it fun, you call it delight, but in reality, the heart is empty and you're lonely and you're missing something and you're wondering what that something is. I'm here to tell you tonight, you're missing Jesus Christ. You're missing the one who took the penalty for your sins. You're missing the one who breaks the power of sin over a person's life. You're missing the one who gives you new life. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. What does it take? Not much. It actually takes you to realize your condition. To change your mind about your condition. "I no longer want to live that way." It simply takes you to say, "You know, I see the Savior. I see Jesus. I see what He's done. I've known the cross all of my life, but I can see He took my death. He took my nature of sin, and He nailed it to the cross, and He took my penalty of those crimes against me. And I can see how He's given me new life." It just takes a simple belief, faith in what God has said is reality. And in a moment, you're born again. That's what that means. Born again means you have new life. Born again means you have new nature. Born again means you have new spiritual DNA. You get that from God. And now all of a sudden, you actually behave like a child of God, like an offspring of God. You do things differently. You act differently. You have no more tastes for things. They change. That's the way it's supposed to be. I'll never forget my coach in high school. He was a big man. He was a cross-country coach, but he was about this wide. I don't think he ran a mile in his life. He was, he was in the Navy. He had a huge Navy tattoo on both arms. And he told me, he said, "You know, Steve, before I was saved, I was afraid I couldn't give up smoking and I couldn't give up drinking. Then I realized that after I got saved, God took those desires away. I didn't want to smoke anymore. I didn't want to drink anymore. I didn't want to go with the women anymore. I didn't have those tastes anymore. God fixed me, Steve. God fixed me." God can do that with you tonight. That's His business. This is His specialty in terms of spiritual medicine. He is an expert at this. Let's bow our heads. Tonight, Father, we come in the name of the Lord Jesus, and we realize that our spiritual condition is really dreadful. It's terminal. We're walking time bombs of death. You saw our condition. You saw exactly what we were, and You interjected Yourself into humanity in such a way to take my penalty, and not just take my penalty, but sever the control of such a heart for once and for all, so that now I now have a new heart, a new way. And that's the divine nature of God in me. Father, I thank You. You've done this plan of salvation so fully that someone can actually not be reformed, but be transformed. And I pray, oh God, there would be souls today that would be transformed. In Jesus' name.